Yes. The Orphanage was the first script I wrote. I wrote it before I had ever shot anything. I made the short film that was called 7337, and I made it as a present, sort of to present myself and show it to producer so I could direct The Orphanage. And in the process, I met Juan Antonio at a short film festival. And he had already his production company and Guillermo del Toro wanting to produce a film. So I let them read that script as a sample of my work so that they would hire me to write something else. But they all loved it so much that they said, let's do this one. And then so it when he ended up doing the film that I wanted to make. Oh, we had lots of discussions, but lucky for everybody, he didn't pay much attention to my idea. And it's always different. When people say it's exactly the film I had in my head, I'm always a little suspicious because it's like making a movie is like having a kid. You can have plans for him, and you expose him to the art and the sports or whatever that you anything that you like. But he takes a life of his own, and the same thing happens with film. You select the talent you want to work with, but then there's a moment where the movie decides what movie it wants to be. So you guide it, but it becomes a creature that has its own life. So it's always surprising, and there's always interesting things that come from there. And I think one of the best things Juan Antonio does is he allows the film to change. And when I work with him as a writer, it's crazy because he always shoots the script as it was, and then he improvises on the day and lets new things happen, and then you have to incorporate that into the script. So it's like when you work with him, you have to be on set, and the film is alive and changing. Yeah, making the film was really exciting because it was the first film for everyone involved. It was my first script. It was the first time Juan Antonio directed. The cinematographer, the sound designers, it was the first time that Belén Rueda, the actress, had a lead role in a film. She came from television. So it was there was a very special energy in the shoot. And of course, we had no idea that the film was going to become so popular. Because we thought it was a risky story. It wasn't very common at the time to mix drama with horror, and some people kept warning us, it's like, it's too emotional, make it more scary. And I was always like, no, it's the emotion that's what's making the scary parts work.
Je ne supporte pas les mensonges.
Je suis pas un menteur, c'est toi la menteuse. C'est toi qui dis que t'es ma mère alors que t'es pas ma mère.
It was quite a surprise when the first public screening of the film was at the Cannes Film Festival. It played at the Semaine de la Critique, and I was terrified. I thought they were going to trash the movie, and suddenly it's like there was an energy in the room. It was fantastic, and there was like this 5-minute standing ovation, and it was we were very surprised. We had no idea it was going to be that well received.
Chérie.
The funny thing with The Orphanage is that in Spain it was perceived as sort of a kind of an Americanized version. it was felt as something foreign. And at the same part in the U.S. or the rest of the world, they perceived it as very Spanish. So it's strange, and I think that it's having that type of classic Gothic story, but set in a universe that you're not used to seeing it, that kind of made it special. Yeah, there's always a pressure on what you're going to make next, but the biggest pressure would be not to make anything. So it's always such an incredible privilege to be able to make something you love. And when we made the transition from The Orphanage to The Impossible, the only thing that we knew is that we didn't want to make another horror movie, because we felt if we followed up The Orphanage with another scary film, we would just get typecast in that type of film. So it was important to us to do something very different in the surface. But actually, again, even The Impossible and The Orphanage have things in common about the bonds, the mother-son relationship, and how you come face to face with death. We were making another film right after The Orphanage, and suddenly the production fell through. And we were really depressed because we were already 6 months into preparation. And the day after, Belen comes into the office and she says, I have the story for your next film. And she had listened to Maria's story on the radio. And she said, I have listened to this and we're going to make this film. And I was like, are you crazy? Where are we going to get the money to do that? It's like, don't worry about that. It'll fall. If we tell it right, we'll get the money. And that's what happened. We wrote the script, and then Lionsgate just managed to get the financing for it right away. But it was imposing, of course, because it's like The Orphanage is such a small movie, and suddenly going to shoot this humongous special effects film with tons of extras and action and shooting in Thailand and this huge reconstruction. It was a challenge, but that's when you learn things, just try attacking things that seemed too difficult at first. It was a completely different approach when we work on The Impossible, because we were telling a real life story, and I worked very closely with Maria Belon, who is the woman who lived through that, and it was very interesting, because I think memory is a tricky thing, and on the day that I met Maria, I was shocked by how precise she was with her recollection of what happened. And because 11 years ago I had this really horrible car accident. I fell off a bridge and into the train, and it was really awful. And I have no recollection of the moment of horror. I remember this. I remember losing control of the car, going to the edge of the bridge, and then just waking up late, like 3 hours later. But that moment where the car was plummeting 20 meters down is completely erased from my memory. So one of the things was like, do you really remember everything that happened, or is it somehow a reconstruction from tiny bits of memory? And so we talked to the whole family, and there were common elements that everyone had the same memory, and others that had to be sort of like reconstruction, and it was fascinating to go back and sort of like check the story with other witnesses and find the pieces. It was a really interesting work, but it was tough also, because you have an extra responsibility when you're telling a real life story where so many people lived through that tragedy, and especially in particular with Maria, you wanted to tell her story. She, the biggest challenge was to make sure that she recognized herself in that movie. It's always about a character who's trying to go back to a home that no longer exists. And that can be said of The Orphanage, The Impossible, and Marrowbone as well. So yeah, it's always the same story.
Je les ai pas retrouvés.
Il y avait beaucoup de gens morts.
C'est très grave ce qui s'est passé, tu sais.
T'as pas vu maman et Lucas, hein?
Non, je les ai pas vus.
Je me suis brûlé les pieds sur le toit. C'était très très chaud. Et tout le monde partait.
Oh.
Et nous, on va partir?
There's certain directors or writers that always tell the same story, or at least have certain themes that are always there. For example, if you think of the films of Steven Spielberg, who's probably my favorite director, in every single one of his films, he talks about the separation from the father. And they're very, very different films. But even those who are completely, who had nothing to do with that theme, he ends up incorporating them, like in the Indiana Jones movies, by the third chapter. I was a little scared because, well, I've lived in the States and I can talk, but writing dialogue in English is an entirely different thing, because film dialogue sounds nothing like real dialogue, and it has nothing to do with literature either. It's you need to communicate lots of information with very few words, and it needs to sound natural, but it cannot sound like real people talk. So I was a little afraid, but I guess it was like the perfect film to write in a different language, because everything is so basic in a situation like that. It's like there's just like short orders and truthful things, and so, and also it features a cast of people from all over the world, so they didn't have to speak the perfect English, and there's many languages in the film, so it was an interesting thing to try. It's delicate, and actually when we got to Thailand, some people there were a bit iffy about the movie, saying it's like, you're gonna make a film about this, but what's the approach? But I think, again, it's like, it's not, the film is it's set in the background of this tragedy, but it's a movie about fear of separation. It's about things that the bonds that link you to your family, and it uses that context to talk about something else. And I think that we found a way. Everyone, after we screened the film, many people who had been through that came to us and to say that they really felt that the film was respectful what they had lived, and also the final note of the film is if you want an homage or a remembrance to everyone who was there. It's so I think we managed to succeed in making an emotional movie that was truthful and respectful.
Ne laisse pas emmener sur toi.
T'inquiète pas, maman. Je te laisserai pas toute seule. C'est promis.
Allez, allez.
Où est Daniel? Rika, où est Daniel? Je sais pas. Daniel.
I was able to be on set on both of Juan Antonio Bayona's films, but it's been an incredible learning experience making it, not just on the part of directing, but also on the writing. I think when I make my next film, it's gonna be completely different how I approach the writing, knowing that at some point that's gonna have to crystallize on a set. Well, it was very different, and I wanted to make sure that we didn't have any of the same crew members. It's a different cinematographer, different set designer, because I didn't want to, and of course both Juan Antonio and Belen were like, why don't you take the same crew? And I was like, I don't want to be the only one that's changed. So we found a completely different crew, and he's a director who likes to have complete freedom on every decision. So here, as a producer, he completely stepped away, and he was there just to make sure that I had I enjoyed the same freedom that he had on his films. He did very much what Guillermo del Toro did on The Orphanage. It was just a figure to protect the film, but he didn't intervene in the shooting. Actually, I always remember something my a teacher told me in school at NYU, that it's like the fastest way to direct something was to write three successful films, and then on the fourth one you can impose yourself as a director. So that was my case, although it wasn't exactly fast.